all the questions, and there was only one question where more than half of you missed it. Just one. So that was on the Dupuytren's contraction, which I was kind of surprised that that was one that was frequently missed, and it's that you should, you know, split it in extension.
It sounded like claw hand because we were describing the contracture, which sounds like claw hand to me, and I knew claw hand was splitting it in the minus, so that's why.
Right, but if you would, this would be intrinsic minus. A claw hand would be split into intrinsic plus, which then you would put MP flexion, which would create a huge contraction for Dupuytren. So with Dupuytren, you want them splinted in full extension, post-op. Okay? All right, so now we're going to get on with the shoulder, okay? So we didn't really cover any shoulder, we didn't at all cover any shoulder. Oh, I didn't make copies.
Yeah.
That's okay.
No, I need this.
Shoot.
Do you want me to, I need some. Does anyone else need any?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Yeah. All right. I will get on it. Mary made them. I can print that real quick from here.
Huh?
I totally forgot. I would think it'd be more on my radar. But with respect to anatomy, we're going to be going through a lot of muscles. And you know from previous tests that I've given you, I'm not big on memorizing all of the muscles, right? So you don't have to know all of the muscle names. Sorry, I can't talk and help. Of course, you have to log back out and log back in. CAS. I spent an hour of my day wasted logging out and logging back in.
Yeah. And he's like, no.
Is that a baby?
Yeah.
He asked me, why don't you go to my All right, so Mary's going to bring the copies in. They'll be in shortly. While you guys were all taking your test, I just submitted a proposal for Miota on shoulder injuries. So hopefully I'll be presenting this topic, a varied version, because the Miota conference, for those of you that are staying in Grand Rapids, so not Shivani, but it's going to be in Grand Rapids in the fall. October 6th and 7th. You can come back and see all your buddies. So. All right. So the thing with shoulders is, I just wrote in my little abstract thing, shoulders are commonly referred to physical therapy. Commonly seen by physical therapy. Like Dave, you work in an outpatient PT clinic. What's the percentage, if you were to guess, the number of people that are seen in your clinic by PT with shoulder pathology?
You mean how many go to PT or OT? Or how many?
I'd say 50%
of
the
population shoulder.
What's that?
I'd say 50% by shoulder.
And do they go
50% are probably shoulder. And how many of those go to PT versus OT?
Most of them start at PT. Some of them go to OT, but not very many.
So most of them start at PT. Why do they go to OT?
Because
they use all their Medicare dollars and they have to switch to OT.
Right.
That's why.
Depends on their coverage.
Yeah. So they go to PT first as the primary provider, even though we're supposed to be the experts in the upper quadrant, right? They go to PT first, and then if they use all their Medicare dollars, then they might go to OT and finish them up. How does that make OT represented in the world of shoulder pathology? Not very good, right? So you guys need to learn this material to get comfortable. And again, I'm not going to quiz you on all the different muscles of the shoulder and the scapular joints, but if you're going to work in outpatient OT, you can either choose to give all those cases to PT because you don't want to learn the anatomy, right? Or we can reclaim the upper quadrant and take all those cases back for our profession, right? Because in the clinic that I used to work at, shoulder pathology was the number one diagnosis referred to the clinic. You know, when I got a shoulder patient and I felt very comfortable with treating the shoulder, when I was slow and they wanted to fill my schedule, I'd get a shoulder patient. Otherwise, they went to PT. So you guys gotta learn it. It's nowhere else in our curriculum we're gonna learn how to treat the shoulder for orthopedic conditions, right? So you gotta learn it, all right? So we're gonna go over the anatomy briefly, but if you work in outpatient, you should learn the muscles. You're not gonna learn it, you don't have to learn it for this class, but you should learn the muscles, how to evaluate, and then some common diagnoses that are seen when treating the shoulder. So in looking at the shoulder, we have to look at the bones, the joints, and the muscles. We have to look at the whole big picture, right? That's with everything. And we're going to go through this kind of quickly, but you guys can review this on your own and study it, because if you don't know the anatomy, right, you really can't treat it. If you don't know what things are in there, how can you figure out what's wrong, right? And many times we get a referral from family docs, right, that just says shoulder pain, right? They're leaving it up to us to figure out what the culprit is, right? So we have to figure it out. So we have the clavicle. You guys all know where your clavicle is on your body, right? I could bring in Mr. Bones in the clinic, so we could bring him in. Or I think last year they made a different name for him. You guys named him? Was it Mr. Bones? Yeah. I think it was Dave's patient that then did come back in.
Oh, guy?
Anyway, we all know where the clavicle is, okay? Connects the axial skeleton to the upper extremity, all right? It's an attachment site for many muscles, so it's important to consider when we're figuring out things about the shoulder. And it protects a very important neurovascular bundle, which would be what? The brachial plexus. Goes right underneath there, And then we have our scapula on the backside, right? Which we might call our shoulder blade, right? Covered in muscles. And the position of the scapula depends on the activity at the glenohumeral joint. So our scapula moves as our arm moves, okay? And then we have the humerus here, right? Which is a proximal lever arm, lever should be, not L. And it's a site for an attachment of many muscles. So when you're looking at the shoulder and evaluating the shoulder, we just can't look at the shoulder, right? Just we can't look at this joint. We have to look at the clavicle, and we have to look at the scapula, because it's all one big shoulder complex, okay? Have to look at the whole thing. Okay, and so when we talk about joints, we have to also look at the whole thing. So we have the sternoclavicular joint, where our sternum attaches to our clavicle, right? So don't get freaked out by the name. So if you just take a minute and think about it, it's logical and it's telling you where the joint is, right? And then we have the acromioclavicular, which our acromion process is out here, and this is where it attaches to our clavicle, okay? So we have our AC joint, and then sternoclavicular SC. SC joint, AC joint. Not exactly here and here, okay? Our SC joint, you know, we've been talking about this fuchsia. And there's lots of things that you can injure with a fuchsia, which we've kind of talked about a little bit, right? You could have a distal radius fracture. You could dislocate your elbow. You could fracture your clavicle. You could fracture your humerus. You could also muck up your SC joint, because that's a cushion for when we fall. So when you have this axial loading situation, it's like a domino effect the whole way up the upper quadrant. You have to look at the whole thing. The AC joint is frequently injured in athletes, but when we're looking at an older population, these joints can also have arthritic changes in them from movement with poor posture. Think of everything that we do in our life is forward, right? Whether we're a teacher and writing on the board, or we're a hand therapist and we're working with our patients, or I'm working in a factory, or I'm a baker, or anything, hairdresser, forward, right? We don't do anything back this way, right? Nothing. So those joints can get compressed. And then the glenohumeral joint is a really particular joint because it has a huge amount of range of motion. Because think of all the planes, the glenohumeral joint. What planes does our glenohumeral joint move in? Flexion, extension,
adduction,
abduction, horizontal AB and abduction, internal and external rotation, right? Lots of planes of motion in the shoulder. And it anatomically is at a disadvantage, because our humeral head is big, and the glenoid process where our humeral head rests is tiny. Okay? So, anyone ever tell you like to not take kids and spin them around in a circle, right? Because what happens to their glenohumeral joints? Dislocates, right? Or the kid that's having the tantrum and throwing itself on the floor, and the mom picks it up in Walmart and drags the kid by the arm out of Walmart, right? Dislocates the shoulder. Because it's inherently unstable. Large amount of range of motion, big humeral head, little teeny glenoid, right? So the only thing that's holding that joint together are muscles. So think about our neurologic arm. When we have hypotonia in the shoulder, what happens? You get subluxation of the shoulder, right? Because the joint's not going to hold it together. The muscles have to hold it together, and when they don't have tone, they're not going to hold it together, and the humeral head drops or subluxes downward, right? And then you describe it by one finger or two fingers, because the joint is inherently not going to hold it in place, or the ligament is structured. The muscles are the only thing that holds that up there. And then it's stabilized by the rotator cuff is a biggie, and I don't know why I didn't finish my thought there, because I just have a comma, but also the labrum is another soft tissue structure that stabilizes the glenohumeral joint. Labrum, L-A-B-R-U-M, the labrum. Okay. Okay. And then we have our scapulothoracic joint. It's running the scapula. Okay? But this just shows that picture. Here's our giant humeral head, right? Well, here's a better picture of the bone. Here's our giant humeral head and our little teeny glenoid, right, that it rests on. Okay? It's kind of like a golf tee and a golf ball, right? A big wind is going to blow that golf ball right off, right? And then this structure here, can you see that circular kind of ribbed structure there? That is the labrum. So the only thing that's stabilizing that keeps that big humeral head on that little teeny glenoid is this little lip of soft tissue that holds it into place, your labrum. So do you think we have inherent problems with stability with this joint? It's the number one joint that is dislocated in the body, is the shoulder. Okay? So we talk about this stability. We have some ligamentous structure, but our labrum is the biggest thing that provides stability or prevents dislocation of the shoulder. Okay? And it makes like a little teeny cup. But it's not a big cup, you know? It's a little lip. Like, I think it looks kind of like, which is a kind of a bad example, but I always use it, like a condom resting on the glenoid cavity. Right? It's not a big giant ridge. It's just a little lip around it. So it's inherently unstable. Okay, so then we got lots of muscles involving this whole shoulder girdle, okay? So we have, we've heard this word before, extrinsic and intrinsic, but we're going to use it a little bit differently. But I'm not going to go through all of these muscles, but you have muscles that attach the thorax to the limb, the vertebrae to the limb, and the vertebrae to the humerus. So we have lots of different groups of exercises, of muscles, lots of different groups of muscles. And then we have these intrinsic muscles that attach the clavicle to the humerus and the scapula to the humerus. Okay? Okay. But the big thing to think about is, and then we have all these scapular muscles, okay? Because our scapula has a lot of planes of movement too. We protract and we retract our scapula. We elevate and then we depress our scapula. Lots of different movements for that. And our scapula, look at all of the muscles. Like when you look at, I look at these grocery lists of planes of movement and I look at the number of muscles that do different jobs. Look at the number of muscles that are involved in scapular depression. Yeah.
How do you measure scapular protraction and retraction? We have to do it for our range of motion.
I don't.
Can you just do it by how far your hand goes forward?
I guess you could probably measure from the media from your spine to the medial border of your scapula, and you would measure the distance that you would protract. I've never measured that. I don't think we need to. I don't think you have to. Are you talking about for advanced clinical reasoning?
Yeah.
I don't think you have to measure staff promotion. Ask
WFL.
I thought she was saying, I thought she was saying like
WTF.
Yeah. That's what I was
thinking.
That's the way it sounded, like too much information I don't think you have to measure that, because I was talking with Tracy about that. I don't think you have to measure that.
Okay.
But as I was saying, lots of muscles for depression. So when we push ourselves up from the floor or the chair, we need a lot of strength. So this would be a more of a load bearing, where we don't need a lot of force in this scapular protraction and retraction, right? So we're not, we don't have a ton of muscles that work in that plane of motion. Okay. All right. So just looking at the muscles, if I were you, I would learn these muscles if I was going to a level 2 field work in upper extremity or in outpatient rehab. I would learn these muscles. And I would also learn them if I was going to a dynamic place where I was going to be treating stroke patients, like a Mary Freebed, or places like that, because they're going to ask you what muscles are working with this patient and what muscles are not. Okay? So I don't need to go over these for you because you can read them and look at the pictures, right? So we don't need to spend our time doing this. But look at, and the thing that's important to note in the shoulder is we have things anteriorly, right? And the things, then we have things that are posteriorly. And if we don't have balance, that's when the posture gets out of alignment. Like if my anterior muscles are tight, my posterior muscles are longer and weaker, right? The only way that I have balance in my posture and symmetry is by having balance, really, between the anterior muscles and the posterior muscles, because they work against each other, just like our flexors and our extensors provide balance, right? When one's tight, you can't have motion in the opposite direction. Same thing. So our these all address our posture. When someone has a poor posture or a limitation in asymmetry with posture, you have to look at these muscles and say, what's tight and what's weak? Because something's got to be tight, something's got to be weak. Okay, so here we go through all these long muscles. And here we have our trapezius muscle, upper trap muscle, which is a big, huge, giant muscle, which I can guarantee after all of you were just studying for a test, you probably have tightness in that upper trapezius muscle, right? And because we all sit in our, I'm also to blame, with my laptop on my lap in my bed with all kinds of pillows propping me in this rounded position, right? And I have poor posture, so my upper traps are working, I'm all hunched over like this, and I'm creating all this imbalance. But I can guarantee you, nobody ever has weakness in the upper trap, unless you have a spinal cord injury that created that weakness. Because our upper traps are on fire because of us doing things incorrectly. So if you have tension, doesn't it hurt always like right up here? Upper trap. So when people ask me, how do I manual muscle test the upper trap or scapular elevation, right? Why do I care? It's not going to be weak. I can guarantee you, it is not going to be weak. Unless you had a spinal cord injury, that muscle is not the one that you're thinking of weakness, okay? All right. So now we look at functional movement. Our scapula has to upwardly rotate when we move our glenohumeral joint, okay? I should probably get Mr. Bones, but I can probably show you through some pictures in my horrible drawing. Now there was a marker in here yesterday, so I was in here. And Aubrey's not here with the marker, so I'll program a marker. But so our scapula upwardly rotates, which is caused by the upper and lower trap and serratus anterior, and then it downwardly rotates with this big grocery list of muscles when we bring our arm down. Okay? And then we're looking at this big grocery list of muscles, you can see. Okay? And then at our glenohumeral joint, we have a whole list of muscles, and many times we have some overlap where muscles do more than one plane of movement, right? We have like a little safety net. But look at the ones that have the most muscles. What do you think they are when you look at this list? Which muscle, which plane of functional movement has the most muscles? Adduction has a lot, right? And what else?
Internal rotation.
Internal rotation has a lot. When we do joint protection techniques, do we tell our patients to carry things out here or out here or this way? Because we're the strongest in internal rotation and adduction. And when I was reading literature on this several years ago, I read something that promoted the need for that for like mothers to run with their children and escape a predator. Like you grab, you scoop up your kids and you hold them in tight and you run. So these are the strongest muscles for internal rotation and adduction. But it makes sense, right? Makes sense. If I'm picking up a big bag of dog food, I'm hugging that sucker, right? Care or horse grain even more, 50 pounds, right? I'm holding it in this way, right? Because that's my most bang for my buck, internal rotation and adduction, right? So do we think that my adductors typically get weak? Do I typically have trouble with adduction strength? No. But look at my abductors. I don't have a lot to recruit from, right? And look at my external rotators versus my internal rotators. I'm at a disadvantage in those muscle groups, right? Okay. So let's talk about scapular rhythm. But let me get my marker, unless someone happens to have a dry erase. So, for the first 30 degrees of glenohumeral.
Can we go see if the PowerPoints are ready?
Oh, Mary said she would bring them when they're done. There was 25.
Oh.
You can.
Maybe she's taking them.
Go ahead.
Okay.
For the first 30 degrees of glenohumeral flexion, okay, so my glenohumeral joint moves from 0 to 30, okay, no scapular motion, nothing, no scapular motion at all. But after 30 degrees motion at the glenohumeral joint, my scapula moves along with my glenohumeral joint a ratio of 2 to 1. And that is important to know so you know what to expect with your patients. Okay? So if I have, I'm gonna do some math, right? If I have 60 degrees of glenohumeral joint motion, how much scapular upward rotation should I expect? 50. So nothing happens the first 30. So 60 minus 30 is 30. And then it's a 2-to-1 ratio, right? So that's 30 minus half of that. I would expect 15 degrees of glenohumeral upward rotation if I have 60 degrees. So people can get caught up about measuring scapular motion. But do you think it's essential that I measure it if my patient only has 60 degrees? Of glenohumeral joint motion. It's hardly nothing. It's even going to be at 15 degrees. It's hardly anything to even be able to see on a goniometer. So don't worry about it.
Worry about it as your patient starts to get more glenohumeral joint. Then you want to be watching the scapula to see, make sure that it upwardly rotates. Because here's my scapula. This is not to scale or anatomically correct, okay? So here's, it's a triangle bone, right? And it has this spinal groove along here. And out here is my acromion, okay? And then I have my glenohumeral joint here, okay? Here's my humerus, okay? There's my head of my humerus. And here is my acromion. When I reach overhead, do you see how this is going to be putting pressure here? Okay? If the scapula does not upwardly rotate when my humerus goes overhead, what is going to happen to this here? Pinching. But does anyone know what, this is not anatomically correct.
The cartilage?
This would be your supraspinatus tendon. So it's very important that this upwardly rotates the way that it should, okay? And another factor that makes an important point with this is our external rotator muscles, which are part of our rotator cuff, okay? Our muscles that externally rotate our shoulder, which we know are inherently weaker than the ones that internally rotate, right? The muscles that externally rotate my shoulder keep the head of the humerus depressed when it reaches overhead. So if those are not strong, this might pop up and again squish my supraspinatus muscle tendon. Okay? I just want to bring that up. So the purpose of this scapular rhythm, again, is to prevent impingement. Have you heard of impingement syndrome with shoulder pathology? It's a very, very common diagnosis. Very, 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 I promise you, you will see it in level two. Unless you work with peds, because peds don't really get impingement. It's an adult pathology and worsens with age. But this is what impingement is talking about. This not working correctly and impingement of the, typically the supraspinatus muscle. Okay. She's not back yet. Let me go check on her. Should we take it? Well, we only have 35 minutes. I'm going to go check. Then we're all going to go out missing. It's like on the scary movie when one person goes. Oh, look, she's back.
They got stopped, so.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Good job, Andrea.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah. And then it was on paper, so I was just stapling wild.
Did I miss a lot?
Good thing you checked them.
Yeah, or else we would never got
them. Okay, so everyone has their handout if they want. Okay, so somebody share with Andrea about the scapular rhythm. So when we evaluate the shoulder, we're going to be looking at a lot of the same things we do when assessing the general upper quadrant, right? Pain, range of motion. I'm going to compare active to passive. If my patient with shoulder pathology has poor active but full passive, what does that mean? It's a strength issue, not a joint issue, right? If they're both bad, they have bad active and bad passive, then what am I thinking? It's probably a joint problem. It could be both, but nothing can happen until I fix the joint problem, right, to work on more of the strength. But I'm also going to evaluate posture. I'm going to look for different other observations. What else might I be looking for different observations in the shoulder that you should just maybe kind of have picked up along the way that you might see with patients. I might look for anything that doesn't look the same on the left to the right, any kind of asymmetry. If my shoulder's like, if I walk in like this, like that's an observation that I can clearly say something's not right. Either my right shoulder is elevated or my left shoulder is depressed, right? I'm gonna look for asymmetry. What else might I look for? So I might look to see if they walk in and they're like this, what am I going to be worried about? Guarding, right? They're not swinging their arm when they walk like we normally do. They're protected. They're not giving me that wing, right? No way. So I might be thinking about that. Someone else said something over here. Winging. I might be looking at the shoulder for winging. Can I see it if they have a big sweatshirt on? No. So a lot of times when you're assessing your patient, if they'll let you, take their shirt off, you know, go in a private room, if for sure if it's a girl, but sometimes men are very comfortable taking their shirt off in the clinic, but sometimes they're not. So go in a private room and really look at their shoulder. I'm going to look for the scapular rhythm. I'm going to assess it, right? And then I usually start with things that I think are going to be less irritating first and work my way down to the more irritating, like maybe muscle testing, after I already checked the range of motion. And then why do you think I would check their grip strength? They don't have a hand issue. Why would I want to check? Why would I waste my time, right, checking grip strength?
When you have weakness proximally, you also have weakness distally.
When you don't have proximal stability, your distal function is going to be bad, right? Think about it, if you're a tree, right, and your tree trunk, woodpeckers have been at it, right, and they have been pecking holes all around your trunk. A good storm's gonna go, right? No matter how strong that branch is, it's likely gonna blow, right? We need proximal stability for distal function, so likely we'll have decreased grip strength. Even though they don't have a problem in their hand, but they don't have proximal stability. So let's talk about how to assess for the shoulder, because I wanna make sure everyone is comfortable with it, okay? Pain, you know, we usually use the pain scale, right? That's really a subjective report. We're not observing their pain. This is the patient's subjective report. And then I'm gonna measure active and passive shoulder motion, okay? When I measure active motion on the shoulder, I do this typically, preferably in standing, but sometimes I'll do it in sitting if the patient can't stand well. But I prefer to do it in standing because that's how we do a lot of our functional tasks is in standing. And if your patient has a poor seated position, so say they're in their chair and they're, I can't move very well because I rode my horse Monday and then I went to yoga yesterday and to sit is a little uncomfortable. So if they're seated like this and they have posterior tilt, they're not, I'm not getting good glenohumeral joint motion, right? So when I stand, I'm gonna have a clearer picture of what my patient can do. So I try to always check active motion in standing. And then when I check passive motion, I always do it in supine. If I take your shoulder, and it's hurt, right? If it wasn't hurt, she wouldn't be coming to see me, right? If I take her shoulder, and here's another thing, is this is the first day I've ever met her, right? She doesn't know me. She's new to the clinic. I'm gonna be evaluating her. Her shoulder's hurt, and I'm gonna take it, and I'm gonna move it around. Now she's very relaxed, because she's comfortable, right? She's been here, 8 weeks? But in the clinic, she just met me, and she's not gonna give me her arm to let her move it. So you have to get patients supine for passive so they can relax and you'll get a true, accurate measurement. What happens if you measure your patient and your active motion is higher than your passive motion?
Guarding.
That patient is not giving you that arm, right? Guarding. You can document it and you can show that, you know, this is what I have, but it's likely the patient is guarding and not allowing me to take the joint full through the full range of motion. And if my patient is guarding, do you think it would be better to focus on active range of motion or passive range of motion? Active. Because otherwise, you're just playing tug of war with that patient and you're never going to get anywhere if they're guarding. So I'd like to measure someone's shoulder. Does anyone have like a little t-shirt on or something? Would you let me, would you be my patient? Does anyone have any shoulder pathology, I should ask, in here? You have shoulder pathology, and you have on a little t-shirt.
I had both of them operated on.
What did you have done?
I
if you don't mind me, you don't have to share if you don't want to.
I just totally destroyed my labrum. Like, it was gone when they went in and operated on it, and then I split my bicep in half on my left arm playing volleyball. Like, I totally blew up my whole rotator cuff.
And okay. So you want to check out your shoulder?
Yeah.
Does anyone else in here have any shoulder? I know Dave had some asymmetry.
Oh, good. I did my ACP.
You did your whole program, so now you're good. anyone else have any shoulder problems?
Actually,
Susie, you're off the hook on this one, right? Here. So this is our new patient, right? And we're going to assess active range of motion. And we don't know what we're going to find, but we hope we find some problems, right? So I'm going to first assess her active motion, and I'm going to have her flex, right? And I'm going to have her go up, and we're going to put the goniometer here, right? And I'm going to hold it, and I'm going to come down. And the people that have been in my clinic know this, but like your patient's in pain, and you are not skilled at reading this goniometer, right? So if your patient goes up and like they're hurting, right? And I'm like, is it the white number? Is it 120 or 64?
10 more seconds.
Let them come down. Put the goniometer, hold it. If you just hold here, it'll hold it in place, right? Let your poor patient come down, right? And then you figure out what makes the most sense. So we saw her move, right? Right? Would that make logical sense to be 66 or 114? 114. Because we know that that's 90, right? So don't get freaked out. Freaking out makes you not be able to read the goniometer. Okay? And then there's all these red numbers. The other red number would be 18. That makes no sense, right? Or 18 on the other, or 22 on the other side. Or here's one that could be a red number. 290. No sense, right? Or my other option would be 250, which makes no logical sense. So don't get freaked out about the goni, because you're smart. Right? And you're somewhat know that zero to all the way would be 180. So it's gonna be somewhere in the middle, and 180 would be unlikely, especially that they're coming to you, right? So let's go again, and we'll just see, because now I'll get an accurate measurement, right here. So she's got 146, okay? That's active. And if I measured her passively, we would get her on the mat. Okay? And then I'm going to want to know abduction. So I'm going to have you turn this way. Okay? Now, here's another thing. If you take your arm and truly leave it abducted, you cannot go over 90 if you keep your palm down, right? If you go forward, because I get all people, yes, I can. That's if you don't keep your shoulders completely abducted and you go forward, you can. Right? So if you tell your patient and you demonstrate to them in this way, they will not be able to go higher than this. They have to externally rotate to clear the bony block to go all the way up. And what do I already start noting about her when I'm just looking at her? She's hypermobile, right? So I'm already, like, my observations, right? I'm picking up, oh, she's hypermobile, right? So, sorry. So now for abduction, I'm going to measure here, okay? Get my thing, hold it, and let your poor patient come down, right? So I got 152. That's good, right? And then I'm going to measure external and internal rotation. So here would be where I would start, okay? If my patient didn't have good limohumeral joint motion, I could measure them down here at 45. I'm going to write that in my chart that I measured her at approximately 45 degrees of abduction when I measured IR and ER, okay? But most people can get to here, okay? And then I'm going to put both ends here, and I'm going to tell her to gum up, and I usually use the term wave to a friend, right? So you're going to gum up, wave to a friend, and look, she has kind of hypermobile. Can you see that? But we already know that she's hypermobile because her elbow extends too much. So she's got 94 of external rotation, okay? And then I'm here, and I'm going to measure internal rotation. And this is where people cheat, right? Because they want to do really good. They want to get a good score, right? So they'll come in, and then to adapt, they'll bring that shoulder forward. They'll go like this, right? So don't let them bring this forward, because that's cheating. Yeah. So if we really, truly hold her here, and I don't let her cheat, what do we think about her internal rotation? But there's cheating happening. Let's try it again. So we're already thinking we got to give her a home program, right? 25. Okay. So I'm going to look at the other side. So does that match what you would think of someone who's hypermobile? Now we'll see this side. And I'm watching the whole time to not let that go forward. But with this side, oh, okay. Here she goes again. She's 30. But a lot of times you might have to have one of your coworkers just come here and hold their shoulder like this, because it's people want to do good for the most part. Sometimes you'll get someone that doesn't want to go back to work, right? And they won't do well. So active motion. I know in functional assessment you might have learned about measuring horizontal AV and adduction. I don't typically measure. You can measure extension. I typically don't measure that a lot, but you can measure it. But the planes of movement that we need to be most concerned about are flexion, abduction, IR, and ER. And if you just do this, can you do this? She can do that. You just can't do that and know if they have normal shoulder motion. If they're coming for their shoulder, or even if they have a distal radius fracture and now they have shoulder pain, measure. And if, you know, like, you probably know this, if there's a problem with flexion or abduction, there for sure will be a problem with IR and ER. Okay, so can we look at the back? All right, so now I'm going to be looking for asymmetry, okay? So do we see any difference in height? I know it's probably uncomfortable, but just try. Do we see any difference in height here between your shoulder heights? That's one thing that we would look at.
It's kind of hard to hear. Well,
yeah, it's hard to hear.
Yeah.
So it's kind of hard to check, right? But the scapula does not lie, all right? So I'm going to go to find her scapulas, okay? And I thought the right was higher, but I'm closer. Here's her inferior border of her scapula on the right, and here's her inferior border of the scapula on the left. Do we see asymmetry?
Yes.
Yeah, sorry. So I can objectify that, because we don't want to just put in our note, her shoulder's higher on the right than on the left. Could your sister probably point that out? And she's not an OT or brother, right? We want to write it in a skilled way, so I'm going to measure it. I'm going to look at the inferior border of the scapula, and I'm going to use my little goniometer, if it has a level in it, sometimes good, right? And I'm going to take this difference here, and then I'm going to measure it, the difference in height in centimeters. And she's 3 centimeters elevated scapula on the right as compared to the left. Okay? That is a skilled way to document it, and I can document it if it changes. I can report if it changes, right? Another thing that I can look at is I can look from her spine, from the inferior border of her scapula, distance, and then I can look at her other side. Is there a difference?
Yeah.
Right? So I can measure that. Her scapula is also protracted, right? So I can measure using my goniometer in centimeters the distance from the inferior border to the spine, right, is 7 centimeters on the left, and when I look at the right, 9.5, 9.5.
How do you know if that's not a spine?
I don't know that it's not a spine curvature, but how many of us have curvatures of the spine? Probably a small percentage, right? She's coming for shoulder pain.
Yeah.
So it's more, she's not coming for back pain. I mean, maybe she also has back pain, but it's more likely that it's something wrong with the scapula. I don't know if it's a curvature of the spine. Like, that would probably be on her medical record if she had scoliosis, but usually people know that. We get screened for that as kids, right? So we know that she's elevated and protracted on the right, and I can objectify that. Okay? So, when something is loose, something is tight. Right? If there's a problem on one side, there's usually a problem on the other. Okay? Are you opposed to lying on the floor?
No.
Okay? Would you lie on the floor right here on your back? Sorry. See, you never know. And can you lie? Oh, perfect, just like that. So then I'm going to see if I can get down on the floor, back up myself. Okay, come on down. So I'm going to put my patient next flat on a mat, not on the floor, right? But we're just making do. And so now I'm going to check to see if her pecs are tight, all right? So I can measure from the middle of the acromion to the floor. And this one's longer, so you got to kind of hold it out of the way. On the right, and I use it in centimeters, so she's 14 on this side, and then I'm going to measure here, and she's 11. So we're just uncovering the mystery. So I know not only is she weak in the back, but her pecs are tight here. So just while she's already down here, right, for purposes of explanation, I can then stretch it. Right? I could, I can just stretch it this way, right? I could take a little towel and put it on her spine, mm-hmm. under her spine, and I could really stretch it more. Does it feel tight when I stretch here?
Yeah.
So she's tight. Yep, I can stretch that. I can also have her stretch it at the corner, I can stretch it in a door jam, all those kind of things.
How did you measure that?
I'm gonna find the middle of her acromion, which is not very scientific. It's a feel to the center, right? And when I find that, I'm just gonna measure in centimeters the distance from the mat to the middle and compare right to left. But you can kind of see from here, do you see it? Do you see the difference? You can visualize it to know without measuring that there's asymmetry.
Nancy, what do you write when you document that again?
So I'll measure pec tralis tightness,
right.
Noted, the distance from the mat to the middle of the acromion while the patient's in supine.
Okay.
Left,
I couldn't remember
one number, right, another number.
Okay.
So again, I'm objectifying it. I can measure progress, look at change, show improvement, all those kind of things. Okay, I'm gonna get back up. Yeah. Okay. So I measured her.
Don't go away yet.
Are you okay staying up?
Yeah.
Okay. So I measured her range of motion. We looked at posture, and I could also look for things like head forward, which she really doesn't have. But some people, as they age, we get this head forward thing. I might have head forward in my observations or some other things about asymmetry. I should also look for scapular winging. So we're going to turn you around again. And we're going to look at her scapulas. And what I want you to do is just raise your arms up. My shoulder's sore from yoga. Up and down. You can't go fast, right? You can't see. Up and down, kind of slowly. And let's watch to see that her scapulas are upward rotating and that we're not having winging. So let's see. Go ahead, up.
Yep.
And down. And up. And what does she do? Watch her shoulders. She elevates every time she brings her shoulders down. Do you see her doing that?
Yeah.
Do you think her upper traps are tight and strong or weak and loose?
Tight.
I'm guessing they're going to. Do you have pain up in here a lot of times?
Yeah.
Let's keep going. I'm not seeing any winging though. Are you guys?
No.
No. Okay. And if you are suspicious, like, I think she's winging, but usually it's pretty obvious. Those of you that have seen it before, it's obvious. And sometimes it might clunk, clunk when it comes back down, okay? And so just for the heck of it, though, I'm going to show you how to measure the scapular upward rotation. So her spine, I know, is here, right? And her medial border of her scapula is here, okay? If I take her arm and she flexes it, I'm going to follow the inferior border of the scapula. Now it's up here, right? And when she comes back down, it comes back down to here, okay? Now she has little scapulas. So she's kind of hard to measure because she has really small scapulas. Some people have big scapulas and they're a lot easier to measure. But we're going to measure her. So the biggest mistake people make is they get caught up on holding the goniometer here and they lose the medial border of the scapula when it's going upwardly rotated and they can't find it. So put the goniometer down, right? I know the medial border is here, okay? Even if I turn around 3 times and I come back, I can guess it's there, right? I don't have to keep my hand on it all the time. Because I know her spine is in the middle and her scapula, I can visualize it, right? So I'm going to have her flex all the way up, and I'm going to follow that scapula. It's way up here, okay? I'm going to go back to the medial border, and I'm going to move to here, okay? And watch that your patients, if they're teeter-tottering or whatever. So it's about 46 degrees of scapular upward rotation. What was her flexion? Like 142? Okay, so she's 142. If I take away 30, because no movement in the first 30 degrees, right? Which makes us to 112, and I divide that in half, I would expect about 60. But people are variable. Like when you look at range of motion norms, there's variances in that, right? So if I didn't know, if I was worried, I just go over to the other side. And now I'm going to check this side. And I'm going to have her flex all the way up. I think she has more on the side. She does. She has 58. So that's a big difference in scapular upward rotation. Do you have shoulder pain on the right?
You do?
Yeah. Where does it hurt? Up here, we know, because she hikes every time she moves her arms.
And on occasion, if you're up, I can actually get it sublux in as well.
It does sublux. So that is a labrum problem, a labrum instability. And sometimes people have their labrums repaired
and it's still not stable, and you have a chronic